Okay, tonight we're talking about a topic I think that we never really spoke about in depth before. And this is the wonderful opportunity and the mitzvah that we have every single week of Shabbos. And one of the most elusive parts of this very special day is that if we don't really understand what Shabbos or Shabbat is really all about, so then it comes and we eat and we drink and we sleep and we eat and we drink and we sleep and we eat and we drink and we sleep a little bit more, and the next thing you know, it's Havdalah, it's over, and it's out onto the streets for Saturday night, and we don't really get the real essence and the glory of what Shabbos is really all about. So I'd like to speak tonight, we'll try Be'ez Hashem, to give an introduction into what is Shabbos, or what our, how to get ourselves ready for it. So perhaps when Shabbos comes around this week and the weeks after that, we'll be a little bit more prepared. The Gemara says over the following, Mishetorach be'erev Shabbos, somebody who is torach, somebody who works hard on Erev Shabbos, on Friday afternoon, oichel b'Shabbos, they will eat on Shabbos. If you're busy in the kitchen all day long on Friday, making the challah, baking the cakes, running to the store, buying everything that you need, if a person does that, says the Gemara, you work hard on Friday, oichel b'Shabbos, you'll be able to eat on Shabbos. Umishalay tarach b'erev Shabbos, someone who doesn't put in the effort, someone who doesn't work hard, someone who doesn't make the challah and cook the chicken and roast the roast, then meheichan yoichel b'Shabbos, from where are they going to eat? With what will they eat on Shabbos itself? Very simple statement. If you prepare, if you work hard, if you cook everything you have to cook, so then you will certainly have what you need to eat on Shabbos. If you don't, you don't cook, you don't make, you don't do, then there won't be anything that's available for that, for the person to eat on Shabbos. There's a beautiful story that I once saw years and years ago. This goes back, must be about 23 years ago or so. I was a bachar. I was learning in yeshiva in Neri Yisrael in Baltimore. And at the time, the JCC in Baltimore, which had always been very Shabbos observant friendly, they decided that they wanted to start opening up on Shabbos. And the community was very tight-knit. The Jewish community in Baltimore was very tight-knit. And the religious people went up in arms. And they said, this is a Jewish community center. We use it. You use it. Everybody comes and exercises there. And there's no reason it has to be open on Shabbos. Leave it open on Sunday the way it always has been. But don't open on Shabbos, please. And there was a lot of pressure from the community that wasn't religious. And they kept saying, no, we're going to open up on Shabbos. So the religious community organized a very big, I guess we'll call it a protest. It was peaceful protest in a big auditorium. And they bust in all the yeshivas, they bust in all the Beis Yaakov girls, all the people came that day from town. And they brought some of the best speaking rabbis from the town to come and to give drushes to come and speak. And the whole thing was to inspire us to realize you don't need it to be open on Saturday, you can exercise just fine 6 other days of the week. So if you only have the Stairmaster on Sunday instead of Saturday, it's going to be okay. One of the things they had was a video. And in the video, they interviewed somebody by the name of Rabbi Shlomo Porter. And Rabbi Porter runs like the biggest kiruv organization in Baltimore. And he told over the following story. There was a woman who was coming to his classes. And she and her husband were not religious. And she was getting very, very interested in Yiddishkeit, in Judaism. And she, in fact, was so inspired by the classes, and they'd gone a couple of times to spend like a meal at someone's house on Shabbos, she wanted to keep Shabbos in the house. So she came to Rabbi Porter. She said, I don't know what to do because my husband doesn't want to. So they spoke about different things she could do. She said, you know what? I have an idea. So, sure enough, she tells her husband, you know, I've been learning, I've been studying, it's very exciting over here, and I'd like to start keeping Shabbos. So he's like, Shabbos? What's Shabbos? She said, you know, the seventh day, we rest, we don't turn on the TV, we don't go places, we don't go to the beach, we don't go to the movies, we don't do a lot of things, but we get to enjoy ourselves. So he's like, listen, I'm not into this Shabbos thing, I got a lot of other things that I have to do on Saturday, we're not going to keep Shabbos. Okay? He comes home that Friday from work, comes to the front door, and the door is locked, which is unusual. He knocks on the door, and the door opens up, and his wife is dressed in an elegant gown. She has her jewelry, makeup, perfume. He looks inside the house. He sees the table is set with china and crystal. The house smells delicious. She tells her husband, come, come. He says, what's going on over here? She said, Shabbos is coming. He goes up to the bedroom. The bath is drawn. There's a glass of wine. There's a cigar, whatever, waiting for him. She says, here's your nice clothing. Go get ready. When you come back down, we'll have Shabbos. So he prepares himself. He comes downstairs, and sure enough, his wife, she outdid herself. The food, everything, the wine, dessert, roast, chicken, soup, you name it. And they sit and they have a beautiful, delicious meal together. At the end of the meal, so the husband says, you know, Shabbos not so bad. So she says, so we can start keeping Shabbos then? He says, well, I'm not really so ready for that. Next week, comes home Friday afternoon, comes to the door. He doesn't even try to open the door this time. He knocks on the door. Once again, his wife opens up, elegant gown, makeup, jewelry, and the same story repeats itself. At the end of the meal Friday night, once again, the wife says, so, do you think we could start keeping Shabbos in our house? And the husband says, look, you know, it's a big change, a lot to do. I'm really, really, really not ready for such changes. Okay, his wife says. Next week, comes home Friday afternoon, standing by the door. He knocks on the door. There's no answer. He knocks on the door again. There's no answer. So he opens the door. He walks inside. The house is a mess. The pillows on the couch are on the floor. His wife is running around like she's like a chicken with her head cut off. She's a mess. She's dirt all over her. Clothes are unkept. He looks at her and says, what's going on over here? She said, oh, such a busy day today. There's so much going on. I'm so stressed out. He said, but Shabbos is coming. What about Shabbos? She said, oh, you want Shabbos? Okay, if you want Shabbos, then we'll have Shabbos. And that's how she got her husband to start keeping Shabbos in the house. Mi shetorach be'erev Shabbos, somebody who works hard on Erev Shabbos, Oichel b'Shabbos, they will eat, they will enjoy, they will take the pleasure of Shabbos on the Shabbos itself. Which means the following idea, that you can't just jump in on Friday to Shabbos. And you can't jump in on Saturday morning into a Shabbos. The way in which a person is best going to be able to enjoy and partake of, and to glean the most of the Kedusha, of the holiness of that Shabbos on Shabbos, is if a person finds themselves preparing for that Shabbos during the week itself. I remember when I was learning in Kollel in Baltimore, so my Chavrus and I once had the following discussion. Who enjoys Shabbos more? Those of us, we were sitting in Kollel at the time, we woke up in the morning, we went to Dovid, and we went to the yeshiva and to the Kollel all day long, we were learning. And at night, we would come home, we'd have dinner, then we'd go out again at night and we would learn more. So who enjoyed Shabbos more? Those of us that were sitting and learning all week, engaged in the study of Torah, of our davening, of our tefillah, of working on ourselves, or what we would call the typical balabas, the typical working fellow who woke up in the morning, he went to daven his minyan, he learned a little bit, but then he was working all week long. So we asked, who enjoys the Shabbos more? The one who's living all week? We were learning codes almost like Shabbos, like all week long. You're not doing that much. physical activity. You're sitting and you're learning and you're engaging in the Word of God. And then the other person is running around all week, busy with business and this, phone calls, this, emails all over the place. Finally, Shabbos comes, Shabbos, Menucha. Shabbos comes, you can begin to relax and you can take it easy. So who gets the most out of Shabbos? The one who's running around busy all week long and finally, is able to rest? Or the one who all week long is working in the world of ruchnius, working in the world of spirituality, and Shabbos is like a heightened level of that awareness. So we concluded that the person who enjoys the Shabbos the most is the one that is living throughout the week in the world of ruchnius, in the spiritual world more. Because that's the preparation that a person is going to make for Shabbos. The more that you are connected to your neshama during the week, the more that you are connected to Kedusha, to holiness during the week, the more that you guard yourself from being in places and doing things that you know are antithetical to your religious nature that you have inside, so then when Shabbos comes, you embrace the Shabbos in such a way, it is exciting, you are looking forward to it, because it's like the icing on the cake of what you did throughout the week. But a person that's busy running around all week long and he's in so many different worlds and so many different places, it's harder to come to the Shabbos and to bask in the glory and to enjoy it in that way. That's why, you probably don't ever see this, but in shuls on Shabbos afternoon, there's something called mincha, then you have suda shlishis, the third meal, then you have marav afterwards. The average person in the shul on Shabbos afternoon cannot take their eyes off the clock. They are waiting. When is Shabbos going to be over already? I got things to do. I have to go places. I have phone calls. I have emails to answer. I have business I have to make. The whole Shabbos has gone 23 hours of Shabbos, and you're holding by the last hour, and they're like itching to get out of that room. You know, once Shabbos is over, that's it. Back to, quote-unquote, reality of this world. You would expect that a person by the end of a Shabbos would be, Nebuch, Shabbos is going to end soon. I'm going to have to go back to my emails and my WhatsApps and my phones. And it's horrible. But it's just the opposite. A person who throughout the week is engaged in the world at large has a very hard time to enjoy and appreciate and to envelop themselves in the Kedusha, in the holiness of Shabbos. So what I would like to speak about tonight is the idea of using the week to prepare ourselves for Shabbos. And then, of course, if a person wants to prepare themselves properly, you have to know what it is that you are actually preparing yourself for, which means we should understand a little bit what we can, what is this glorious day, this glorious day of Shabbos all about. So the Gemara says the following, Amalei HaKadosh Baruch Hu LaMoshe. Hashem said to Moshe Rabbeinu the following words, Matana Toiva Yeshli Bebeis Ganozai. I have a Matana Toiva, a good gift that is stored away in my treasure house. V'Shabbos Shema, and the name of that good gift is called Shabbos. V'ani Mevakesh Litna LiYisrael, and I desire to give over Shabbos to the Jewish people. Leich v'haydiyim, Moshe, go and tell them. Let them know that they're about to receive the most magnificent present that I could offer to any nation. And that's called Shabbos. Of course, this is after we receive Torah. This is when HaKadosh Baruch Hu is now ready to give us everything that he has so that we should appreciate what it means to be a Jew. And he's telling Moshe, let's give them the greatest gift and that special treasure that's hiding away in my treasure house is called Shabbos. So the Ion Yaakov writes over here, what is this Matana Teva? What is this good gift? So he says, Matana toiva lefishu yoy menucha va'oinig. Why is it such a present? Why is Shabbos such a present? Because it is a day of peace, va'oinig, and pleasure. Umekabel schar alof. And what is the real treasure? It's a day of peace. It's a day of pleasure. And on top of that, you receive reward for keeping Shabbos. It's not a bad deal. Imagine you go to your favorite restaurant and they serve you the most expensive thing on the menu, which happens to be your favorite, and you eat it and it's delicious. And as you're leaving, you give them the credit card to pay and they say, no, this is for you. And you open up the envelope and there's five times the amount of money as the dish itself cost. And you say, what is that for? And they say, well, this is your present for enjoying our food. Thank you very much.
Sounds like a good deal.
Sounds like a good deal. Says HaKadosh Baruch Hu to Moshe, go and tell the Jewish people, that's the deal on Shabbos. I'm going to give them a day of menucha, of peace. You can't have peace during the week. There's too much going on. I'm going to give them a day of oinig, of pleasure. Everything that we do on Shabbos is called oinig Shabbos. We eat and we drink and we sleep. You take a nice walk, a stroll outside and enjoy the beautiful weather. Everything, you're with friends, with family. It's oinig, it's pleasure. And on top of that, says Hashem, I'm going to pay you for it as well. Keep Shabbos, eat cholent, have challah, eat some yummy dessert, have another scoop of ice cream. And we'll load you up at the end. We'll load you up at the end of the day with tremendous reward. And then he writes, "What does it mean that it's bebeis ganazai, that it is in my treasure house? Ki al yedei shmir Shabbos, through the keeping of Shabbos, meisim adam alibay, a person begins to realize, shashem yizbarach bara hakoil b'sheishes yimei amaiser." Hashem created the entire universe in 6 days. V'Shabbos b'yom ha'shvi'i, v'Shabbos b'yom ha'shvi'i, and he rested on the seventh day. V'Shabbos meramiz al olam haba. Shabbos itself is symbolic. It hints to us about olam haba, the world to come. Shuyom shekuloi Shabbos, in that world, the world to come, it's going to be all Shabbos. Ayyadei kein nichnos, and why? Because we're saying Shabbos is menuch, it's peace. Shabbos is oinig, it's pleasure. Shabbos is basking in the glory of the Shechina and getting all the reward for that. The world to come, our sages tell us, is exactly the same thing. You will have peace. You will have pleasure. You will be dovik, you will cling to the Shechina, to the divine presence. There will be tremendous tranquility and happiness and joy that you will experience in that world to come. Shabbos is supposed to remind us. That's why it's called Shabbos is Me'ein Olam Haba. It's like the world to come. It's 1/60th of the world to come. You can tap into that world of menucha, of peace, of tranquility, of happiness, of pleasure. And just remember, Hashem continues to reward you for enjoying yourself. And then he writes, Al yedei kein nichnos yiras elokim b'libay. When a person realizes that this is what Shabbos is all about, the awe of Hashem will enter into your heart. Mipnei haboreshu bal yecholas kulam. Because you realize that Hashem is the one who creates the world. He is the one that's running everything. He is doing everything. There's nothing that is stopping him. It's all up to him. Like it says, Yiras Hashem hi oitzroi. The fear of God is like a storehouse for you. Lachi kamashu bebeis ganazai. That's why it says, Shabbos is in his storage house. What's the treasure house? The treasure house is that it's the world of the awe and the reverence and the appreciation that a person will have of Hashem. That is what this special day is going to do for you. But if you don't understand what Shabbos is, if you don't realize it's a day of true peace and rest and happiness and joy and pleasure, you know, the whole week you have to worry about your diet. That's the whole week. The whole week, you know, all the cookies are on the table. You see, no one's even eating these chocolate rum balls over here. Because you made a calculation, how many calories is in one of those rum balls, and you said, it's not worth it. But on Shabbos, you don't have to worry about that. You can eat one, you can eat two, you can eat 10. It doesn't matter. You take the bonbons, sit on the couch, eat the whole container. It doesn't really matter. Because on Shabbos, there's so much oinig, there's so much pleasure. And that pleasure itself is designed in such a way that Hashem wants us to enjoy ourselves. Why do we spend so much time focusing on the physical? If it's such a holy day, such a spiritual day, such a day of menucha, of peace, why is there's a mitzvah to eat tasty food and to drink delicious drinks and to make sure that you sleep? You know, the acronym of Shabbos, Shin, Beis, and Tov, stands for Sheina B'Shabbos Ta'anuk. Sleeping on Shabbos is a pleasure. That's why you have to go to bed at a good time. Sleep in till 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Wake up, eat your meal, go back to sleep for another few hours till Shabbos is over. Sleeping is a pleasure. Why do we spend so much time indulging in the physical pleasure if it's such a spiritual day? So we find throughout the Chumash in different places where surprisingly the Torah makes a great emphasis on the physical pleasure of a person. And we see that when Yitzchak was going to give over the brachas, the blessings to his son, Yaakov. I mean, he thought it was Esav, but it really turned out to be Yaakov. So he told Esav, go and bring me the matmanim, go and bring me the delicious food that I love to eat so much. Prepare it for me, barbecue, with some spices on top, a good glass of wine, exactly the way that I like it. So there's a book called Maspik, the Maspik Lo'evde Hashem, which is written by the son of the Rambam. And he asked the question, Yitzchak Avinu is about to give over the biggest blessing in the world. He's about to give over the biggest blessing in the history of mankind. He's going to bless his son, who he thinks is Esav. It turns out it's going to be Yaakov, who's going to have the legacy of the Jewish people for all of history. Now, if you're about to give over such an amazing bracha, such an amazing blessing, so what would you be doing? You wouldn't be eating a barbecue. You wouldn't be eating ribs and drinking wine. You would be fasting. You would be davening to Hashem. You would ask, please, God, let's make sure that everything that I'm going to do right now is exactly the way that you want. I'm giving over the most powerful bracha in the entire world. Why is Yitzchak eating a steak? Not just a steak. We're talking about ribeye, big. Why is he doing that? So he answers, because in order for the neshama to be able to soar in the ultimate way in this world, the body has to be taken care of perfectly. And once that the body is taken care of and satisfied and has the pleasure that it needs and it is at ease, then the neshama radiates and shines and is able to express itself in a very deep and holy way. The same thing is with Shabbos. Shabbos is a day where we see, if you look inside of you look inside the songs, the zmiros that we sing on Shabbos, it talks over there about the tasty food and the fatty meats and the sweet delicacies that we eat and the sleep that a person is going to get. Why? Because the body has to be groomed. The body must be taken care of so that it's silent, so that the real essence of who you are, the neshama, can begin to reveal itself and express its glory on Shabbos. How do we do that? Again, like I said, you can't just fall into a Shabbos. If you begin to prepare yourself during the week, getting yourselves ready in ruchnis, in the spiritual realm, you're learning, you're working, you're going to shiurim, you're having conversations about good things that are spiritually inclined. So then when Shabbos comes, so that day has such an impact on the person, especially when you're eating good food, especially when you're relaxing amongst good company and friends. So then the spirit that you invested inside of yourself throughout the week, it comes into fruition on Shabbos itself. Just like a person, we would say, who wants to run a marathon, they have to train. A person who wants to be able to play some kind of sport, they've got to practice. A person who wants to be ready for Shabbos, the only way to get ready is you have to prepare throughout the week. The Gemara says further. The Gemara says that on Shabbos, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives us what's called a neshama yesera. It is called a neshama yesera, an extra soul. We have an extra soul on Shabbos. What does it mean that we have an extra soul on Shabbos? In the turn of the century, in the early 1900s, so many of the Jews were escaping from Europe. They saw that the oppression after World War I was becoming very difficult to survive over there. And they heard that in America, which was called the Golden of Medina, the golden country, over there there was money, over there was a future, over there you could live in the right way. And they were warned as they were coming on the boat rides over that you need to know that the Yiddishkeit that you have in Europe is not the same religiosity that you can have when you're going to be in America. In Europe, you live in a shtetl, you live in a close community, there's Shabbos, there's Yom Tov, there's Kashrus, there's Davening, there's Tefillin, there's behaving and acting and being proud to be a Jew. In America, it's not like that. There was no real frum communities the way that we have today. There weren't schools the way that we have today. There weren't butcher shops or markets or restaurants the way that we have today. And to get a job and keep Shabbos was very, very difficult during that time. So they were told that if you really want to make a livelihood, you're not going to work on Shabbos. I mean, you are going to have to work on Shabbos. You can't do it any other way. So there's stories of the Jews as they're coming on the boats over from Europe to America, where as they're getting close to the harbor, they would throw their tefillin overboard because they were told, you can't have tefillin and live as a Jew in America and think that you're going to survive. So we find that there were two types of Jews that developed at this time. One was the Jews that no matter what, we are keeping Shabbos no matter what. We're not going to fall to the pressures of the American society and the world around us. We are keeping Shabbos. And you had other Jews that said, what can we do? When in Rome, you do like the Romans. So here we are, nobody keeps Shabbos, we can't keep Shabbos, we have to get a job. So there's a fascinating study that they did later on, let's say in the 1940s, 1950s, 60s, of all of the children that were raised in these homes. Which are the kids that ended up being dedicated to keeping Shabbos in their lives? So we would have imagined that all of the children that came from the homes where they saw that their parents were for sure we're going to keep Shabbos, we're never going to not keep Shabbos, we have to keep Shabbos, that's what Hashem wants us to do. We would imagine, you see your parents self-sacrifice for Shabbos, that means that they would go to a job, they would go to a factory on Sunday, they would get a job, they would work from Sunday to Friday. When they would not show up to work on Shabbos, they would come back to the factory on Sunday and the boss would say, you are out of here. We only hire people that work 7 days a week. So from week to week to week, they were fired every single Friday. Fired, 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 fired. Until maybe they would find favor in somebody's eyes and they would get a job that they could hold on to. So they found staggering statistics. Many of the children who came from such a house, stopped keeping Shabbos. How could it be? Your father gave up his job every week. Your mother supported your father every week. You lived simply every single week because you would never give up Shabbos. How could the children then in that family not keep Shabbos? So they said, because there are two ways that the fathers would come home on Friday. One father would come home, drag his feet into the house, sit down by the table, and he would say, oy, I lost my job again, but Shabbos is Shabbos. I'll never desecrate the Shabbos. Then he would make Kiddush like he's like a depressed old man. They'd eat the meal in silence, whatever meager food they have, and he would keep grunting, "Oy, oy, I wish we had more to eat. Oy, oy." Then he would fall asleep at the table, and that was the end of Shabbos. The other father would come home Friday night, and before Kiddush, he would grab his children, and he would say, "Kindelach, children, come, let's sing and dance. Do you know what Tati did today? I gave up my job for Shabbos because there's nothing greater in the world than Shabbos Kodesh." And he would sing and he would dance, and the whole night he would tell stories to his children on the parsha about Shabbos, how beautiful it is to be a Jew and to serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So they noticed that the families where the father would come home every single week depressed over the fact that he had to give up the Shabbos, his work for Shabbos, those children said, "Why would he want that in our lives? It's miserable. Shabbos is such a misery." And so they decided to take a different path. But the kids who came from the homes where the fathers would sing and they would dance, they would make it so exciting. Obviously, they were keeping the Shabbos. Says the Gemara, a person should realize that on Shabbos, no matter what they go through during the week, no matter how many heartaches and hardships and difficulties and challenges, no matter how much of the life has been sucked out of us from this world, you should know that every single person has what's called a neshama yesera, an extra soul that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has granted us. Says Rashi, what does that mean? Roichev lev lemenucha ulesimcha. Your heart like expands on Shabbos in order for you to be at peace and to have happiness. V'lios pasuach lervacha, it's open wide. V'yoychel v'yishteh, and this is the source of why you never gain weight on Shabbos. Your soul is open wide, your heart is open. V'yoychel v'yishteh, you can eat and you can drink. V'enafshay katsa alav, and your soul will never be detested, it will never be bothered by the indulgence that you have on Shabbos. You're not the same person on Shabbos that you are during the week. You are 2.0. You are new and improved. You are what? You are yourself, plus HaKadosh Baruch Hu piles a neshama yaser, an extra soul, into your life. Where are you going to be able to see that? When you are able to enjoy the tranquility and the peace and the happiness and the food and the pleasures of Shabbos, and you realize it's so just so good, so enjoyable. So then a person is never ever going to feel bad for themselves if they lost their job. They're never going to feel bad for themselves. "Oh, I'm missing out on so much. Oh, my friends, I know they called me right before Friday, before the sun went down and I lit the candles. They're telling me tonight is the biggest party of all." You don't feel bad. They're the ones that are missing out. They don't know that they have a neshama yisera. They don't know they have an extra soul inside of them that's open and expanding and wide open to enjoy the pleasures of this glorious day called Shabbos. When a person recognizes this gift that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is giving us, and they see how He loads us up with a treasure, you get peace and pleasure, and you get rewarded for it as well. You have the treasure house at your disposal. You fill up yourself with emunah, with recognition that how much you see that Hashem does, how He created the world, how He runs the world, how He's involved in the world. You're filled with awe, with the presence of Hashem. And you have now this extra soul that is there inside of you. What could be better in a person's life? What could be more satisfying? What greater gratification could a person derive than the 24 hours of Shabbos? It should be that at the time that Shabbos is coming to an end, a person simply does not want Shabbos to end. You know, I remember once I was with some friends in New York, and we were driving from New York back to Baltimore on Saturday night. And they said, let's go see the Skolona Rebbe make Havdalah. I said, "Havdalah? Shabbos is over like 2.5 hours ago." He said, no, you don't know the Rebbe." I said, "What are you talking about?" He doesn't let go of Shabbos till very, very late. "Let's go see Havdalah." Anyway, we drive to his, into Brooklyn. We drive to this his the Beis Midrash, the shul over there. And sure enough, it's like 3 hours after Shabbos is over, and all the Hasidim are still sitting by the table by Shalosh Shittos. And the Rebbe is making Havdalah. And everybody's listening to every single word. He's a very, very holy man. And the whole scene was very special to see. But perhaps the most impressive part of it all was you have people that are not in a rush. Now, their wives might have been waiting for them. That's true. But they were not in a rush at all to run back into the world. Why would you rush back into the world when the real world of getting close to Hashem is right here on Shabbos? You know why you'll rush back? Because you don't appreciate what Shabbos is. We don't know what Shabbos is. It comes and it goes. The worst thing is when you hear your kids say, Shabbos is so boring. Now, for a child, it could be that it's true. If they don't understand what Shabbos is, the Shama Yisera, pleasure, this, relaxation, peace, they want to active, they want to do things. But we're not children, and we don't remain children all of our lives. We want to mature in our mitzvahs. We want to mature in our Torah. We want to be able to appreciate that which HaKadosh Baruch Hu has given us. And therefore, as Shabbos comes our way, if we prepared ourselves in advance properly, which means that we were working on our ruchnius, on our spirituality, like we say, that anyone who doesn't prepare on Friday afternoon will have nothing to eat on Shabbos itself. So if I'm working and I'm preparing during the week, when Shabbos comes, it just infuses a whole new world of what Shabbos is going to be. When I was learning in Eretz Yisrael in Israel, so one of my rebbeim once came back from Lavai from a funeral. And he said he heard the most amazing hesped, the most amazing eulogy about the woman who had passed away. And he said one of the sons got up at the Lavai at the funeral and he said, my mother, do you know why? And this is a very religious family in Jerusalem. Do you know why my mother was such a tzaddikah, such a righteous woman? My mother made the best challah in the world. And that was his eulogy of his mother. But he explained how she had this recipe that there was no challah tasted any better in the entire world than the challah of his mother. So this Rebbe came back. He says, do you hear that? Do you hear what the mother gave over to her child? I said, good challah, what? What did she give over? He said, the mother put so much effort into making sure that the pleasure that her children would derive on Shabbos was everlasting. The memory that he has the most about his mother's greatness was she was the one that made the house Shabbos. She's the one that brought the oynig, the pleasure. She's the one that made the kids feel there's nothing better than this in the entire world. What, baseball game? No. Being out on the streets? No. Going to a restaurant? No. Sitting in your house together with your mother and your father and your family and imbibing the delicious foods? There's nothing better than that. So we have to ourselves be able to prepare ourselves during the week to appreciate that. Now, what can you do? There are so many books that are written. I don't know where everybody's level of Hebrew is right now, but even if your Hebrew level is not so high, there are so many books in English that speak about what Shabbos really is. And if you will pick up one of these books, and every day, 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, whatever it is, not too much. You don't need an hour. 5 or 10 minutes a day. Take one of the girls that's here, get a chavrusa, make a study partner. You do it on the phone, you do it in person, 5 minutes a day. Learn about how special Shabbos is. Learn what you're supposed to be thinking about on Shabbos. Learn how you're supposed to prepare yourself for the Shabbos itself. And that way, when Friday comes and the sun is going down and you're lighting the candles and you're closing your eyes and you're saying the bracha, you are actually looking forward to the holy day of Shabbos because you know this is the day of peace, This is the treasure from Hashem. This is what's going to bring me happiness. Shabbos is called the Makor HaBracha, the source of all blessing. Don't you want blessing in your life? Everybody wants blessing in their life. And we all need our unique, individual blessings. Where is it going to come from? You don't have to run to Israel. You don't have to run to a great rabbi who's going to give you a bracha. Shabbos is a gift that Hashem sends to us every single week. And the makor, the source of all of the bracha, all the blessing that we're going to receive, it all comes from Shabbos. But you have to appreciate it. So you have to learn about it. The Chavetz Chaim himself writes in his introduction to his volume about the laws of Shabbos, he says that a person who is not learning and reviewing the laws of Shabbos on a regular basis, for sure, they are going to desecrate the Shabbos. Because there's so many details, so much minutia, so many small points, and that if a person is not prepared and understands what the laws are, for sure they're going to desecrate. So that means that as along together with learning about the spiritual aspect of Shabbos and the more philosophical, inspiring aspect of Shabbos, you have to realize as well that if you're aware of the laws and you know what you're doing and how to keep it in the right way, that also has a profound impact on your Shabbos. Kol HaShomer Shabbos, anyone who guards the Shabbos, the Shabbos will guard them. How do you guard Shabbos if you don't know what it means to guard it? The only way to really guard it is you have to keep the laws in the right way. And of course, HaKadosh Baruch Hu is forgiving. And He understands if you're new to Shabbos, if you don't know all the laws, so you make mistakes, Hashem understands that. But as you get more comfortable in the saddle, so to speak, of being a Shomer Shabbos, of being a Shabbos Jew, Hashem expects for us and encourages us to expand our knowledge of the laws of Shabbos, because that is the way that we will be Shomer. We will guard the Shabbos. There is a famous story that goes all the way back to this time also of the families when they were coming over from Europe to America. There was a young lady, Rivka, who was sent by her parents to her uncle and her aunt living in New York. And her parents told her, listen, Uncle Maishi and Aunt Ruchi, they're going to take good care of you, whatever they say you should do. She gets there, and lo and behold, her uncle, who she knew as a very God-fearing man from the days of Europe, he's walking around without a yarmulke. And she sees her aunt, who was once a very modest-dressing woman. She's not dressed modestly. And Rivka's trying to figure out, what is going on over here? And she begins to realize that the pressures of living in America and trying to have parnas and a job and everything had had a very detrimental effect on them. And her uncle sat her down one night and he said, Rivka, listen, this is not the shtetl of Europe. If you want to work and you need to work, that's why you came here, you got to work 7 days a week. That's the only way that it's going to happen. Don't come up with this Shabbos, and you can't work on Shabbos. You got to work 7 days a week. So she goes to work the first week. She comes home Friday afternoon before Shabbos. And her uncle says, no, Rivka, Shabbos morning, go, you have to go to work. She tells him, I can't. I keep Shabbos my whole life, I can't. And he leaves her alone that week. The next week, the same exact story repeats itself. And he tells her Shabbos morning, Rivka, go. You have to go to the factory. You have to go to work. You're going to lose your job. She says, I'll lose my job. I can't lose Shabbos. I'm not going to desecrate the Shabbos. The following week, her uncle says, listen, Rivka, you lost the job 2 weeks ago. You lost the job last week. I got you another job. You're living in our house. We expect that you're going to bring home money every single week. You're working on Shabbos. You don't have a choice. Trust me. You know that I used to keep Shabbos. What can you do over here? There's nothing else that you can do. So Rivka walks out of the house. And she begins walking on her way to the factory to go and work on Shabbos. As she's walking through a park to get to the factory, she sees the bench. And she says to herself, how can I do this? How can I do this, Hashem? Give me the strength. I can't. And she sits down on the park bench. She says, you know what? Maybe my uncle won't find out. I'll sit here all day long on the park bench. I won't come back until after Shabbos is over. And sure enough, she sits there. She doesn't desecrate the Shabbos. She doesn't do anything. She sits there knowing she's keeping Shabbos. When the sun goes down and the three stars come up in the sky, she decides to walk back to the apartment, and she doesn't know if her uncle's going to figure it out. Not figure it out, she doesn't know. She walks into the house, and as she's walking into the house, she hears crying and screaming. She says, "Oy vey, what happened over here?" She comes in, and she says, "Everything all right?" And her uncle says, "Rivka, you're alive! Rivka, you're alive!" She said, "Yes, of course." "Didn't you go to work today?" She said, "Why? Didn't you go to work today?" She said, "Actually, I couldn't bring myself to go to work." He said, "Baruch Hashem, kol ha-shomer Shabbos, anyone who guards the Shabbos, Shabbos will guard them. Do you know that the factory that you worked in was burnt down to the ground today? Not a single person survived, except for you, because you kept the Shabbos, and so the Shabbos kept you." And when the uncle and the aunt saw how HaKadosh Baruch Hu protected this young lady, so it brought themselves back to keeping Shabbos as well. When we appreciate, when we understand what we have, when we understand it's a gift, people, you don't throw money onto the street. You don't throw treasures onto the street. You hold it dear, you hold it tight. In Be'ez Hashem, you're going to get married. Before you get married, your chassan is going to give you a big diamond ring. Make sure no less than 3 carats, okay? And that ring is going to be weighing down your hand like this. And you're going to be holding up your hand so you can show everybody, look how big this diamond ring is that I got. But you're not going to take it and put it in your hand and tell people, pass it around, take a look. It's a treasure. It's valuable. It's worth thousands of dollars. And it all belongs to you. Shabbos is worth more than that ring. It's worth more than millions and billions. It's worth more than all the treasures. Says HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the greatest treasure that I have waiting in my storehouse is Shabbos. Ushma, that's its name. And if you'll understand and you'll live and you'll appreciate it and you'll work during the week to get yourself ready, so by the time that Shabbos comes around, you can't wait for Shabbos. They used to say in yeshiva, hang in there, baby. Shabbos is coming. Yeah, the whole week is difficult and there's so many things that are going on. But you know what? Shabbos is going to come. And once that Shabbos is here, that's it. The Midrash says, how could a person say that they finished all of their work, right? That's one of the mitzvahs that we have. You have to complete all of your work before Shabbos comes. What if you're in the middle of writing a paper for college? What if you're in the middle? What if you're in the middle of some great activity and you didn't finish and Shabbos comes? Says the Midrash, you know what you have to do to yourself? In your mind, you have to say to yourself, the project is done. I did finish the paper. I did finish all the shopping I had to do at the mall today. It's done. Why? Because once that Shabbos comes, all of my work is done. I'm done with everything from the week, and now I'm here. But, again, like we said, easy ways to get ready. Just learn. There's a beautiful book that Rav Shimshon Dovid Pinkus wrote called Shabbos Malchusa. It's called The Shabbos Queen in Hebrew. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, they translated it into English. It's called maybe the glory or the sanctity of Shabbos by Rabbi Pinkus. And in there he describes the feelings that a person is supposed to have on Shabbos, how they can glean the most out of it. Imagine 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day. You just read it, you learn, talk about it, discuss it, think about it. Shabbos comes, you're ready. Take one halacha. There's all these beautiful books. We just started in my shul. On Shabbos morning, after davening, after Kiddush, when everybody's running to go home, we made a shir in the laws of Shabbos. There's a beautiful book. Learn Shabbos in 3 minutes a day. Yeah, have you seen it? Learn Shabbos, not bad, 3 minutes a day. So you have 5 minutes a day of the hashkafa, of the more philosophical, spiritual meanings of Shabbos, and an extra 3 minutes a day of learning the laws. If you do that, you come to Shabbos, you're ready. You are prepared. You're looking forward. You can't wait. And when we get to that point, that's when the Shabbos is something that is unique, and that's when you'll appreciate the neshama, yisera, the extra soul that HaKadosh Baruch has given you. Again, it's which is for menucha and for simcha. Who doesn't want that? Peace and happiness. Peace and happiness. And Hashem is paying you a just reward for such a thing. So, as we said, everybody wants the bracha in their life. And Shabbos itself is the makor, is the source of that blessing. But we have to appreciate what that is. If we put in the time appropriate beforehand, and we're not talking so much time, everybody has 10 extra minutes a day. Yes, that means you'll have to watch one less WhatsApp video. I'm sorry. You will not be able to, you'll watch 10 less minutes of the exciting impeachment trial. Okay. But you know what? If you sacrifice in that, when you come to Shabbos, you say, wow, what a bracha, what a blessing it is. And then as you see the clock is waning, and the hour is getting late, and you realize the stars are coming up, and Shabbos is over, the best thing that could ever happen to you is to say, oy, I'm so sad that Shabbos is leaving. If only it could stay forever. Say Chazal, it will. When you get to Olam Haba, when we get to the world to come, when we get to that place, which is Yom Shekulo Shabbos, is completely Shabbos, you'll be there. But at least in this world, we could be able to enjoy the Shabbos as much as is possible. So we'll give each other a bracha that Be'ez Hashem will find the extra time throughout the week to prepare minimally, nothing major, minimally. But whatever you need, you know, you want to prepare challah and chicken and rice and vegetables and cake and ice cream, takes time. Take the time that is necessary. Prepare yourselves in advance for Shabbos. The Shabbos will be the makor habracha, the source of all of your blessing. And Be'ez Hashem, whatever it is that your heart is so much yearning for in your life, you'll see that Shabbos will be a great zechus, a tremendous merit on your behalf to send you the brachas min Hashemayim, the blessings from Hashem, to give you all of the desires of your heart. You're welcome. Any questions?